to the Neil Haley Show's Caregiver Dave celebrity segment. I'm excited to welcome to the program Caregiver Dave. Dave, how are you? Aloha, aloha, aloha. I am in freezing cold Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
I'm doing great. I'm still here on my balcony listening to the ocean, and you're not.
So, well, that's, hey, you know what? Someday I'll get to do all that travel. I will be going to Vegas in March. So I hope to, you know, get some other great interviews like last year I got in Vegas. I got Bill Medley of the Righteous Brothers, and I interviewed the Blue Man Group. So I'll be heading to Vegas in March. So, but Dave has exciting things going on everywhere. And then when he takes a vacation, it's exciting. And our guest, I'm sure, oh my gosh, the stories he has. So go ahead and introduce our guest.
Well, this is the brother of John Travolta. He comes from a big family, I think five or six siblings. And Joey Travolta, he's an actor, he's a producer, he's a screenwriter. The guy does everything. And he also is very involved in disabled actors and teaching them how to be better. Joey Travolta, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate being on it. And you're in Hawaii right now. My daughter's on her way to Hawaii. And what island are you on?
I'm on Waikiki, but we're leaving today to go to Kona. We've been here about 9 days. Nice. Going to hook up with the family in Kona. They rented a big house. And you're on Interstate 5. You're about to go to my gas station. So go in there and tell them to give you a free latte and make sure they're all doing their jobs.
Yeah, I will. I'll crack the whip, man. Yes.
Joey, we have to have
Thank you for having me on. We
have to have those plugs, Joey, you know, but I mean, I'm just going to go and not have a question, but just kind of just honor you and what you do working with the disabled, because the sad thing about it, and Joey can mention that, then Dave will ask this first question. The sad thing about it is they need people like yourself and even myself when I'm going into the classrooms and school districts to fight for people that are discriminated against, are written off, and someone like you is that advocate that fights for them every day to help them, to give them those opportunities, and you should be commended for it.
Well, thank you. I mean, this the film that we made, Carol of the Bells, is groundbreaking in that 70% of the crew was made up of folks that were neurodiverse that we trained in California. We have several studios in California that train adults with developmental disabilities in filmmaking. And I do camps for children with autism and other developmental, neurodiverse, I like to say. And the dream of all of this was to make a feature, and now we got that opportunity. All the programs came together, sent a couple pros, sent students that were ready to work, and sent them to our studio in Bakersfield, and we shot this feature. RJ Mitty is the main character in it from Breaking Bad, and he is in search of his birth mother. And when he finally finds her, he finds out that she has a developmental disability. And that's the crux of the story. And it's been well received, but the story of how it was made is just as important as the film itself. It shows that when given an opportunity, what folks can do. And these very, very special young men and women got to work with, you know, movie stars and do it, you know, really, because we do short films all the time, but this was through Screen Actors Guild and we had names in it and we did the full feature length and it was released in some theaters. And now we have our big release on March 3rd, which I'm very excited about.
And we're going to definitely talk about
Joey,
that.
I watched the trailer online. Okay. I watched the trailer online. I don't know if it's 60 or 90 seconds, and it was amazing, man. It brought me to tears. It's very, very moving. Good job on that.
Well, it is a tearjerker, and I when I read the script, I was at the Bentonville Film Festival where this premiered, but the year before, and I had run into this woman, Gail Williams, who represents people with disabilities, actors. And I said, do you have a script? I said, I'm looking for something simple to do that's got a lot of heart and feature somebody with a disability. And she said, yeah, I have this Carol of the Bells. And I read it and I cried through the whole script. But I cry at movies. That's the way I am. When we finally premiered it, one of the women that was putting together the festival, she said, we should have tissue boxes for everybody that comes. We'll put them on the seat. I said, what if they don't cry? Then you have like tissues on a seat, and it's kind of weird. So I finally said, okay. And then there's a young man called John's Crazy Socks with Down syndrome that makes socks. And they had run this contest, and someone won a scholarship to Inclusion Films, and he has Down syndrome. And I said, why don't we have him make socks for the movie? So at that same screening, we had Carol of the Bell socks and tissues on the seats. And now there's 300 people there, and the only exit is in the front. And I'm sitting back there by myself, just watching everybody's kind of reaction. But the only way is out through the front. And I'm thinking, if I start crying and I got to leave, it's not going to look good if the director leaves in the middle of the film, because I know it's going to get to me. So I'm sitting back there, and all of a sudden I start crying, and I reach under my seat. There's no tissues. And I'm going, there's no seat, the one seat, and I'm like, my nose is running, my eyes are going, but there was a John's Crazy Socks. So I blew my nose in the foot of the socks and wiped my ears with the leg part of it. So that's my crying story. But when you see it with a live audience, people are affected by it, which it's exciting to me. So.
Well, I definitely think they're affected by it, because ultimately there is somebody in their family or a loved one that has a disability, and that they see what happens.
So 20% of the population has some sort of disability, and they have parents, and they have grandparents, and they have brothers and sisters. So all of a sudden, 50% of the population is impacted by it. So now we're taking that population and putting them to work on a film and training them. So it gives hope to families to say, hey, well, maybe my kid could be involved someday with something like this. You know, we're showing that they can do more than just menial jobs. They can do things that are creative and technical. I mean, half my staff has a developmental disability. And when I go out in the summer, I always take, you know, 3 to 6 students that we've trained to go out and work the camps and get paid and get per diem and learn what it's like to be on the road, but then meet other people that are like them. And then it gives the kids at the camps, oh, well, maybe I can work someday and do this, you know? So that's exciting to me.
Most definitely.
Wow. Yeah. God bless you for doing this.
Oh, truly.
Can we back up to your family? I mean, you come from a huge Italian family. You're John Travolta's older brother.
We're actually half Irish. We're actually more Irish than
half
Italian.
Irish.
Yeah, really? we did the 23andMe and found out we're more Irish than Italian.
Oh my gosh!
I hate to blow the whole Travolta Italian thing, but you got to give it to 23andMe. So I think it was 23andMe. One of those.
What was it like growing up with such a large family, and especially with John? Was he the clown of the family, or do you take that privilege?
I was probably more the clown, and my brother Sam. John is like a sponge. He sees everything and is able to mimic it or whatever. But it was the sisters and my mother that were. That went into show business, and John used to tag along with my sisters to auditions, and he'd end up getting them. He wasn't even there to audition, but he would end up getting parts. And, you know, the rest is history. But my father, when he was, he knew what he wanted to do when he was like, you know, 16, 17 years old. And my dad said, all right, well, I'm going to let you drop out of school, but I'm going to give you 1 year to make it. And if you don't make it, you come back home and finish school. And, you know, he never looked back, you know. So, but yeah, growing up in a showbiz family, you know, it was fun. It was fun. And, you know, even when we get together, we just were together for New Year's Eve, and it was so much fun to, you know, to be together with all my brothers and sisters. So,
was it very competitive? Were you competitive among each other, the siblings?
I think maybe we used to perform all the time, you know. I don't know about competitive. I think we were all very supportive of each other. Well, maybe competitive. I don't know. You know, not when we, yeah. I don't know.
Well, Joey,
I haven't thought about this.
Now, Joey, this is interesting because I grew up an only child, but I have six kids, and I believe when you're in such a big family, you guys, they kind of mesh together. It's kind of strange when you see a big family and some really, really interesting people develop from it. You and John for sure in the acting world, but ultimately everyone finds their path. You're never going to see in a big family a lot of times somebody that is, you know, just an academic genius, because the time that the parents get to spend with each kid, it's a lot of times the siblings working together. It's as I call it, a large zone defense, or put out a net with the number of kids we have to kind of get them to get the exposure they get.
Yeah, we have no academic geniuses in our family.
Yeah.
And would you say, because
no, but we have a lot of talent. We have a lot of talent. Actually, John, I mean, to become a pilot, you know, I mean, when I see what he had to go through to become I took him for his pilot's license when he was 16. He flew a plane before he drove.
Oh, my gosh.
And my father he wanted him to build a plane. He made like this go-kart that was like a plane, but John was really expecting it to fly. So, and believe me, if my father could have made it fly, he would have. But, you know, it was fun. And you know, I'm kidding about no academic geniuses. But I understand what you're saying. No, it was fun. It was a fun family to be in, to be from. And we had a nice childhood in New Jersey.
No privacy, Dave. No boredom, for sure.
Teacher.
Go ahead, Dave. I'm sorry to interrupt you for a second. I was going to say, Dave, that there is
special ed.
There's special Dave. I'm sorry. We'll edit that out. Dave, I was going to say to you that there was no boredom in that house ever.
No, we kept things moving. That's for sure. Yeah, but we were always putting on shows and stuff like that. You know. One of our favorite movies was Yankee Doodle Dandy. And it was like what's his name? James Cagney. And that was like our favorite movie. You know, do you remember the movie? You know, I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy.
Yes.
And it was a beautiful film. And Johnny got to meet James Cagney later, you know, when he was doing Welcome Back, Kotter and coming onto the scene, and they became good friends. Yeah, and that was it's fun, and John is a fan. You know, he's an interesting guy. He's a really good, he's a good man, good guy.
That's great.
We've had several work on a couple of films that he did, and you know, he's very supportive of what we do, and he loved, you know, one of the things that he said was he did a movie called The Poison Rose, and we had five of our folks go down and work, craft service, camera, art department. And he said they were you know, for some, you know, for having, being neurodiverse, they were so attentive and so on top of their job. You know, he was so impressed with them, and hopefully we're going to get them on the next project so that he does too as well, because he's been very supportive of it.
All right, Dave, next question.
Awesome.
Well, I wanted to ask about, you know, your special ed teacher. That's unusual.
I went to college, and I promised my dad I would finish college. I said, I'm going to finish college. And at that time, you know, the teachers, there were a lot of teachers positions, especially in special ed. And so I went that route. And it was really my dad, you know, he had this inclusive, everybody was equal, everybody was the same, everybody was welcome at our dinner table.
Cool.
He was just a kind, kind man. And that's the greatest gift that any of us could have gotten, was inclusion, diversity, and treating everybody like human beings, and that, you know, nobody's better than anybody else. And with that, that's one of the reasons I went into special ed. My problem was I was putting all my money back into the, you know, the classes and the kids. But when I taught, you know, I didn't teach, I performed. So all my lesson plans were performed. I taught in an orphanage for children, and I had kids on all different levels. But my theory was that if kids can watch TV for hours, if you could make your lesson plan entertaining, you know, so, you know, I would teach math through race shots and record a whole card of races and pay them out with candy with when they won, if it was 10th, the one that get 10 pieces of candy, whatever. So it was performance art, not unlike, you know, Hamilton, the way it is now, that you're getting a history lesson, but it's entertaining, you know, that type of thing. So, but I knew I would someday get back to it, and I did. So.
That's really interesting that you took that experience as a teacher, as a special education teacher, and you made it part of your life. And it tells a story. I read it up on Wikipedia before even kind of looking at specifically said, where does this fit, this whole thing? We were talking off air about actors that are choosing to be a help the disabled become part of this profession. It's so important, as you said, if 20% of the population has some sort of special needs, that there has to be more and more actors and actresses that get to perform that have special needs, those roles.
Yeah. There's a company called Lights Camera Access, and their whole big thing is to promote talent in front of the camera. And they've been making a lot of noise and getting a lot. If you look at the landscape is changing. If you look at commercials now, they're being more inclusive. We did a big campaign called Delivering Jobs, and it's basically Autism Speaks, Special Olympics, and Best Buddies got together, and they wanted to create this PSA that was like a utopia of what the what it would be like if people with disabilities were in different positions. And that was the piece. And when they shot it at Fox Studios in California and Los Angeles, and they said, well, we're doing this, we should hire some folks with disabilities to work crew. So they got in touch with me, and six of our folks worked alongside a union crew doing this big PSA. And I said, well, are you doing a behind the scenes of it? Because that's really interesting, showing that you're walking the walk and talking the talk by hiring our folks. So I did the behind the scenes of it. And that, you know, it's a big campaign to include people. And it's 20%. I mean, it's a big buying market. And people don't market to that market, but I think they're starting to do that.
They definitely are.
I had no idea that it was as high as 20%. That's incredible.
Yeah. And then you add their families in. It's a big, you know, population. So,
yeah.
You know, and people can contribute, and people, you know, it's a part of our society, you know. You know, in the old days, they'd hide everything, you know, there's so much to learn from these folks. You learn tolerance, you learn patience, you learn inclusion, and, you know, you know, working with these folks, it's special, and there's so much to offer, and, you know, a good deal of them can contribute a lot, and even the ones that can't, because they teach us.
All right, Dave. Yeah. Dave, what's your next question?
They're special people. Well, I understand you're a singer, and you had a singing career, and I was just wondering how many of your other siblings sang as well. John sang?
Oh, yeah. Well, John had a big hit, Letter In, and You're the One That I Want. I mean, he was, he had an album through mid-song, but then all the movies that he did with Grease and Saturday Night Fever, he didn't sing on, but that was one of the most popular. I was on Casablanca Records, my first album, and then Millennium first, then Casablanca. But my last album was Sugar Hill Records, the rap label from New Jersey, because Sugar Hill, their company was in my hometown of Englewood, New Jersey. And I don't know how I got on the. I wasn't a rapper, but I was, more pop singer. Right. So, but it was fun.
That's interesting. You look at that. You said the performing family. So really, singing came before acting. Then it sounds like, or both. As a family.
No, singing came before acting. But no. Well, actually, my sister Margaret was the first one to have a release. She had like a single back in the mid '60s, and it was just, you know, it was released, and she was on, oh God, I think it was Hullabaloo, one of those shows. I'd love to get that. Was it Hullabaloo from like Ohio or Pennsylvania?
I don't know. I'll have
the Hullabaloo show.
I'll have to look that up for sure. But that's an interesting.
But Margaret was the first one to read. Yeah, I remember getting the single, and it was in our local record store in Englewood. And I remember trying to impress girls with listening to Margaret's 45 record down in the basement of my house. Now, the basement of my house was a theater. So my dad made a little curtain there, and my mom used to teach drama in the basement. And walking down into the basement, you had the Mask of Comedy and Tragedy. And it was really, it was kind of a cool space. I mean, yeah, a lot of fun in that basement.
All right. Next question.
Wow, you know, you've really got a great mission. You're an amazing individual. You've told us so much of your mission. What else are you doing that you haven't told us yet?
Well, you know, we have our own little network called Inclusion Networks that shows the contents that our folks make. And we really, you know, we'd like to do, you know, create a label that, you know, that releases our content, but really caters not only to the general public, but it really is a representation of people with special needs. So that's the overall thing. And, you know, we just keep going. I love what I do. I'm on the road 200 days a year. Traveling to the workshops, doing the camps in the summer, and I love it. And I, you know, it's if people could see what I say, that's why this film is so important, because it's kind of a look into what I get to do.
Yes.
What we get to do, what my team gets to do, because it's very important. The thing about filmmaking is, it's the process where the education takes place. It's the soft skills that you learn by doing a film. Communication, collaboration, having outcomes, project management, and everything that goes into everyday life goes into filmmaking. So it's a great learning tool, whether you're ever going to go into filmmaking at all. It's that process. But nowadays, you know, you can make a movie on your phone and make a good one on your phone. So it's that storytelling, but it's really that sense of family and community that takes place when you make a film.
You know, it's interesting when you talk about all that.
Yeah, you know.
Go ahead, Dave. I was going to mention the thing I have as a mission. I love what he's doing with acting. I'd love to do that with my company. With my digital marketing tech company, is really start to employ more and more special needs young adults, because ultimately they are as hardworking and as good, but sometimes work harder and will be more loyal at times, especially.
Definitely.
And that's something like I have people that you give tasks, and you know, you mess up the task a little bit. That's not a big deal, because we know people that are not even going to do it. So we got to continue to be inclusive in life and really open up opportunities for anyone that needs that opportunity. We cannot just constantly just say we're going to pick the average. There's really no average in life anymore. And people have to understand everyone is different. They can't just go under the radar anymore. That's life, and deal with it.
Yeah.
You know,
well,
everybody's
got to go. Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead, Dave.
I was going to say we had Vincent D'Onofrio from Law & Order, who I think might even be autistic, and he's very involved in something like this as well. Were you aware of that?
No, I was not aware of it, but I'd like to learn more about it, because I think he's a fantastic actor. And I don't know him personally, but I always liked him. I've seen him in interviews, and you know, and it makes me even want to meet him more, because obviously he, you know, he has the same mission
I asked him if he's liked the character that he plays on the show, which I'm assuming was you know, autistic, and he says that would be a good assumption.
Oh, really?
I will say, well, I didn't know that. I'll have to Google that, and we'll have to look at more research. Dave says it like he has it, and it is, and I'm like, okay, all right, Dave, and this is, but I'm going to look into that. But I'm going to make that connection, Joey. I'm going to make the connection with you and Vincent. Okay. I'm first going to send the interview we did about a tremendous program, acting program he was teaching in New York City. I'm going to send that information to you first, Joey, and then we're going to make sure that we get you two connected, publicist to publicist, so that you guys can collaborate, because that's all about life is collaboration. And your mission is to reach as many people as possible with this great opportunity for kids and adults together to be part of this great community. And art is such an important thing, isn't it, Joey?
I don't know why art is being, you know, cut in schools. It's just that, I mean, there's so much that can, you know, and art, you know, they would, what's the expression? A picture is worth a thousand words, is it? Is that the expression?
Yes.
Picture's worth a thousand words? Okay, well... Moving pictures, what's that? When you're taking, you know, what Temple Grandin, the great Temple Grandin,
yes,
thinks in pictures. Most people on the spectrum think in pictures. I thought in pictures. I always, if I picture something, I can make it happen. If I have a concept or whatever, and it is so important to be able, you know, this is why I think filmmaking should be in every school, because
yes,
it encompasses all the audience. You know, all the arts, it's performance, it's art department, it's cinema, it's, you know, all these different things that go into it, law, accounting, everything goes into filmmaking. So, you know, there's something for everybody, and I don't know if I answered any questions.
You definitely answered it. You answered it, and you made sense, Joey, and I never would have thought of that. That was a great teachable moment. Joey and I are teachers. We all know that. I'm a former special education teacher and teacher as well, Joey, so we have a lot in common, and we're both in the entertainment field. I'm in a different realm than you are, but it's an interesting connection. So Dave's has the last question on the show. And so, Dave, go ahead and ask that question to Joey. Go ahead, Dave.
So, Joey, you're kind of a caregiver, too, because you're caring for all these special needs people. My wife had a stroke 23 years ago. She had a headache that turned into, you know, she lost her speech, became paralyzed on one side. And, you know, after we grieved for a couple of years, we reinvented ourselves. And now I travel all over the country. Part of our traveling is here in Hawaii. We've been on 31 network TV shows. We speak on stages like Carnegie Hall and NASDAQ and Harvard. And we just share with caregivers how to stay alive, because 30% of them actually die from the stress before their loved ones do. So my question to you, in addition to your obvious role as a caregiver, have you had any personal caregiving experience with, you know, maybe your parents as they get older, or you worry about them, or anything like that?
No, we, you know, you always think about that, but I have not had that situation. Both my parents, my dad passed when he was like 82. He was in pretty good health right up until the end. And my mom, she went really quick when she was about 67 or 68. But we were never in a situation where we had to give that. And, you know, I always think about it, but I haven't been in that situation with a family member yet. So, it's great that you're out talking, because it happens all the time. So, yeah. And the caregivers. Yeah. So what was the movie I saw the other day? About the caregiver. What was the movie that was out recently? I can't think of it now. This one out. But it was all over a tax deduction for a caregiver. I can't think of the movie now. It's terrible. I'm getting old, guys.
Well, yeah, join the club. I'm going to be taking these interviews I've been doing. I'm writing my fourth book now. My fifth book is going to be about celebrity caregivers and their stories, because everyone seems to have a story. And, of course, your story will be, being a collective caregiver for the special needs actor industry.
Yeah, well, filmmaker, I'm more on the filmmaking side. I'm not as much into acting. You know, there's so many more jobs on the other side of the camera. That's what our focus is. Yeah, you know, I deal with actors with disabilities, but I'm, you know, more of the production side and post-production.
Yeah, see, that's, yeah.
So many for sure. that with autism that edit, and they're really, really good.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they used to, you know, the pieces of a puzzle together with the, you know, what editing is, but they got to learn to tell a story too. But I would love to see one of your talks that you did.
You know, it's
on caregiverdave.com. Just Caregiver Dave, Google those two words, and you'll get it all.
Now,
where do you, are you in California?
Yeah.
Are you in California, or are you in?
Yeah, I'm in LA, right? Yeah.
Oh, okay. Cool.
You guys got to connect. We'll make that happen. I'll make that happen, and also make Vincent happen. But again, you know where Dave is. He'll be at his gas station after his vacation in Hawaii. Now, the last point I wanted to make is, here's the thing. Yeah, you're a filmmaker. Filmmaking and acting, sometimes people get confused and think it's just of acting. And you're right, because everyone has to have an opportunity, and they have find their special fit of creating the film, being the producer, the executive producer, the director, the costume designer, the audio graphics editor. There's just so many things. Kind of shine that point real quick to our audience that always looks at, you know, of filmmaking and think of the actors and forgets everyone else around it.
Oh yeah. That's a very small part of it. When you think about how much goes into it, I'll tell you, you know, culinary, catering, craft service. You guys know what a craft service table is. It's food for the crew that goes all day long. And, you know, they keep it replenished to keep the crew going. And that's a profession. And it's a union position. And when we did our film, like I said, 70% were were neurodiverse, and one of the young men with autism was in charge of the craft service table. He bought everything, he set it up, and made sure that it was replenished every day. Now, I'm the director, producer, so on. Like I said before, that's the guy that's in charge and put everything together. And he was standing by the table. And I walked up to the table. I was on break from the set. And I went to grab a donut. And he was standing. And he said, talking to the guy who's paying his salary and the guy who trained him. But he was right. He was right. And he was on it. And anybody that didn't take a napkin, he made sure that. So later in the production, I'm standing there. And all he had to do was tell me that. And I was always going for without the napkin just to tease him to play, you know, because we like that fun too. And I'm talking to. And he said, just about on budget. He said, there's one area that we're so far over budget, I don't know if we'll recover. Napkins. And he was standing there listening, and he stood at attention that napkins were taking us over budget. Of course, I was teasing. So, but yeah, there's so many positions, you know, driving, location scouting, taking care of the locations, accounting, like we had mentioned before, the writing part of it, someone to make sure. Like a perfect job for someone on the spectrum is script supervisor, because they pay attention to detail. And a script supervisor makes sure if you're picking up the cup with your right hand that you do and you write all that stuff down. Effects, there's so much.
Yeah, there's definitely so much. And best place we can find information on you, Joey, where can we go?
Well, inclusionfilms.com. I'm going to have to get you the call to action. The film becomes available on March 3rd, and it's very, very important that people go and see this movie, download it, or order the DVD, because it'll keep us going to make more films that we can employ people with disabilities.
All right, Joey, and I'll have to find out. This summer you'll be in Pittsburgh, right?
Yeah, I'm there the very last week of the very last week of July, first week in August.
All right. I will.
Yeah. Evolve is a company that's hosting the camp. I'll make sure we get in touch. You'll come down and visit.
Absolutely. We'll definitely do that. I appreciate it, Joey. Thanks for calling. Best of luck.
Cool.
Thanks
guys.
All right. Take care, guys. All right, guys. You're listening to Neil Haley's show, and we'll be back in just a moment. Thanks. We're back to the Neil Haley Show on the Total Celebrity segment. I'm excited to welcome the program Skylar Astin of Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist on NBC. Skylar, thanks for calling. How are
you? Of course, man. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So let's talk about this. Could you imagine that a playlist would be playing when you're talking to everyone, that you talk and have a conversation and that person hears them singing versus having a conversation? It's crazy to think about that.
I can't imagine how distracting it would be to trying to do anything in your daily life and having people break out into song. I would do terrible with that power.
Yeah, and especially knowing their playlist, whatever it is. It could be something where you listen to this one song over and over again and it gets stuck in your head. Can you imagine that, Skylar? We all have been through that.
Yeah, I mean, I have enough trouble having songs stuck in my head as it is. I can't imagine if someone was actively singing that song to me. And not to mention, it's not like Zoe could just tune it out and put like earphones on. It's in her head, so she can't shake it.
Yeah, I'd be going crazy. But then I guess you know their mindset, I guess, based on what kind of song is playing in your head, and it just happens depends on your mood a lot of times. What music's in your head in your playlist?
That's true. Exactly. Can you imagine not only hearing someone's secret, but what if you just don't like that song? That would be kind of annoying. I just don't even like that genre at all.
Exactly. What is your playlist, Skylar, that you currently have that you like walk around listening
My
to?
My current playlist?
Yeah.
I've been listening to a lot of Elton John, I really, I've been like hitting up the 90s stuff a lot, like Hootie and the Blowfish, Don't Ask Me Why. I'm actually looking at my Spotify right now. Let me see. I got a lot of like weird Justin Timberlake. Yeah, it's all over the place. Tygo is very good.
Cool. I'm a big 80s fan, so I'll jam out to 80s music all day long. It's just something like, it just reminds me, because I grew up in that time. I'm 47, and it just like those songs just resonate with me. And that's what a song does to you. And I think this is what the show's cool about the show is you never know what music's going to come out and how much you love that music. And that's cool.
Absolutely. Well, the thing about the show is that every time there's a song selection, and we do span all the genres, even musical theater, we do. I actually sing an 80s rock song in episode 10. We always pick it based on like what makes the most narrative sense for the moment. So, because it has to be literal, the lyrics have to literally translate to the moment. And you can't, for instance, do a song like Shawn Mendes' Lost in Japan, unless you were quite literally lost in Japan. So it does limit things, but it also keeps it specific and meaningful.
And a song is a story. And Skylar, that's the thing that
exactly.
I think that we have songs that we remember growing up that really connect to an experience, right? And I'm sure that those conversations go on set all the time about, wow, I remember when I heard this song.
Right. Yeah. I mean, a lot of people reached out. After I sing I Think I Love You by the Partridge Family at the end of episode one, and I can't tell you how many people were like, oh my god, that brought me back. I used to be such a fan. I had such a crush on the Cassidys. And like I love that. But then there are other moments where we get to take people out of their own experience with a certain song and kind of repurpose it. That I think is when the show is clicking on every cylinder, and we take a song that is, whether it's a Rolling Stones song or a Beatles song or even a Jonas Brothers song, and you don't hear what you normally would hear in that song, but now you're thinking about a specific storyline that it's complimenting.
So tell me about your character really quick, Skylar.
Yeah, I play Max Richmond, who's Zoe's best friend, and he has a bit of a secret. He's completely in love with her, and that complicates things, because not only does he have a secret, she now has a secret, because she knows about his secret. So there's just secrets all around, and that doesn't...
Zoe might use this character to her advantage with knowing what people think.
Exactly. I mean, and that's the thing, is that Zoe is such a kind person, and she's really trying to do her best. So it's like, you know, I don't think it's manipulative. Say Instagram, Twitter, I'm Skylar Astin. So if you spell my name right with an A-R, you can follow me there.
All right, well, I appreciate you calling, and it's interesting to talk about these things with music, and I thought this is a great show for that reason alone, because of the connectivity of music. Everyone loves music, and especially you love karaoke, you love different things, you're going to definitely love this show. So thanks again for calling, Skylar, and best of luck in all your ventures.
My pleasure. Great talking to you.
All right, take care. Thanks. Okay, bye-bye. You're listening to Neil Haley's show, and we'll be back. Back to the Neil Haley Show on the Total Celebrity segment. I'm excited to welcome the program Fran Drescher and Adam Pally of NBC's Indebted. Guys, thanks for calling, and I appreciate you coming by.
Oh, our pleasure. Thanks for supporting us in this way.
Yeah, we're doing great.
Awesome. Let's go, Fran. Now, when you got the script, what did you think of this? Because I was kind of watching different things and of this character and going back to comedy in this way. What are your thoughts of this once you got the script and saw what your character
was? You know, I think that I'm a Boo Jew. That's a Buddhist Jew. And, you know, sometimes it's good to just let the river carry you. And I was about to go out and start pitching ideas for a show that I created that I thought was good for me, but which is normally the way I do it. But this kind of just came to me, fell in my lap. It was described, my character, as a Fran Drescher type. The network was high on it. They were high on him. I like the idea of doing a kind of baby boomer meets millennial show. The studio is the studio I work with on The Nanny and Hotel Transylvania, and is the nearest to my house. My parents were thrilled because they could never find Happily Divorced on cable, and everybody can find the Peacock Network. So, you know, once I met Adam and Dan Levy, I knew that, you know, if they wanted me to join the cast, I could fit in with these people and feel very, you know, like familial with them. and that's important to me. And so, yes. You know, I just decided to dive in and say, okay, I'll join this party.
You know, it's interesting.
I'm a juju. Which is just a Jew.
So, Adam, when you got...
So you swim upstream.
So I swim, I'm a salmon, yes. I'm a religious
salmon. And I'm sure you're pumped up with the cast you got to work with, right, Adam? This is such an all-star cast and such a great project for you.
Oh, yeah, Murderer's Row of comedic talent. I mean, just up top with Fran and then Steven Weber, who is just one of the funniest actors I've ever worked with. And such a joy to be around. And Abby Elliott is so funny. And Jesse Hodges is amazing. So I feel really lucky that I feel like, again, I just lucked into a situation where there's no weak link, and that not a lot of actors get that in their career, and I've had it a couple times.
Hey, Adam, you got to say, you got a great agent and you're a great talent. So there you go, right?
I wish I did. I wish I had a better one.
Now, Fran, tell us about your character.
He's under a lucky star.
Yeah. Fran, tell us about your character now and the premise of the show.
Well, it's I am half of a baby boomer couple who goes broke. They're really clueless about how to spend their money. They're very generous, loving people, but, you know, like just off the scale, out of control, and lose everything through a series of circumstances and come to their grown son's home and say, we're here, we're broke, get used to it. And suddenly the dynamic shifts, and now it's about, well, how are we going to do this from week to week? And, you know, blend these two energies, because in many ways, he's more parental than the parents.
And one of the things that I love the most about Fran's character and Steven's character is that in their financial irresponsibility, the actual tangible things are not as important to them as the love and the time shared with their family. And I can relate to that, I think, as well as a lot of people.
Oh, absolutely. And you see when your family comes over and you're like, okay, I got to change everything. And Fran, that's the kind of thing where you guys move in, then your kids have to kind of change, right? In so many ways, because you have a specific way of how you handle things, right, Fran, that leads to lots of comedy, especially if you knew your parents would move into your house.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. I mean, I'm not a shrinking violet in this show. I mean, I enter a room and I kind of take it over, and it's my children's, problem to kind of adjust around this energy and these forces of life that they have. It's been many years since my son has lived with his parents. And now for the parents to come live with him, it's a real intrusion. But at the end of the day, I think that what solidifies the whole thing is that there is a genuine love amongst the family. And so everybody puts up with each other.
And then, and also a comedy, Adam, that could happen, right? And it could happen that the parents...
Yeah, I think it could very well happen. And if it...
Yeah.
Yeah, if it happened to me... you never hear from me again.
I'd be happy if it happened to me.
Well, if they could be a great built-in babysitter, that's what grandparents are, a great built-in babysitter and great opportunity.
They don't trust us, though.
Sometimes.
Oh, jeez. That's not good. Well, and there you go. But again, anything that has you two on it, I know it's going to be a success for sure. And everyone needs to tune in February 6th at 9:30 p.m. Eastern on NBC. And it's great chatting with you, Fran. And again, anyone in the world knows who you are because of The Nanny and so many of the other great projects you've done. And Adam, continued success. So I appreciate you both calling.
Thank you, sir. Very
much. All right. Take care, guys. See you later. See ya. All right. Bye-bye.
Yeah.
You're listening to Neil Haley's show, and we'll be back in just a moment.